Oh, sorry. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go.
Oh, there we are. It's us. What a day.
Phew. Hey, we made it. Well, okay, so now I've just figured out why the audio was so low before.
Why is that?
Well, I had it turned down, of course.
Oh, well, technical details.
But now I feel so much better.
Well, I'm dancing over here, so.
And a hot cup of coffee and some trumpets in the morning. That's what I always say. That and a great guest on our show, Chris. Who's with us today?
It's the best way to start Wednesdays, isn't it? Trumpets, coffee, and a great guest. And this week, we have Sonia Malik joining us here. Sonia, give us an introduction to yourself. Give us the 30-second bio so folks can, if they're meeting you for the first time, they know who you are and where you're coming from.
Sure. Thank you for having me, Chris and Brent. So Sonia Malik, joining you from a fairly snowy and cold Boston. I am a learning strategist, workforce strategist, wear multiple hats at IBM, but basically I've been at IBM for 25 years, all in the learning space, very focused on the future of skills, the future of work, and building skills to really thrive in this hybrid workforce that we have right now. Mm-hmm. So that's a 30-second elevator pitch from me.
Awesome. And building skills is our focus here today, because you guys have done some interesting things at IBM that we wanted to bring everybody into the loop on and share some insights into that. So maybe we'll start with, you've done some interesting things that we're going to talk about, but maybe talk about the before times, like when, what were you guys seeing that prompted you to start, looking at improving things, et cetera?
Sure. So I think at IBM, we realized about 5 years ago that, the workforce was extremely dynamic and was changing. I think with the advent of cloud and artificial intelligence, one realized that the needs of the workforce was ever changing. And so we had to develop ways in which we could identify the skills of our workforce that existed, as well as try and figure out what the needs were in the future and how to get there. And so we've been on this journey, I think, for the last 5 years, as far as IBM themselves is concerned. And then also looking outwards at our customers and trying to help our customers figure out what are the skills they're going to need, not only to be productive with the IBM products, but just in general, And so, as you know, we've got a lot of workforce initiatives that, fall under what we call corporate social responsibility, to help governments with workforce initiatives, to help universities, to help high schools. So I don't know if, that kind of was where you wanted me to mm-hmm. go.
Yeah, well, let's talk about the problem, and then we start moving into talking about, the things you guys did to start resolving that problem overall. So, based on that starting point, 5 years ago, what did you guys start doing then to start solving this stuff?
So the first thing I think we did was we built out a platform. We built out a homegrown platform that really provided our employees with personalized recommendations and really an ability to be able to tailor the journey. Okay, so let me go back to what I said earlier. Really the way we needed to do this were three things. Take a skills inventory, develop personalized learning journeys, and really build out an ecosystem with the learner at the center of it, right? So those were the three things that we needed to do. So let's start with a personalized, looking at an inventory of the skills. I don't know how many of you are familiar with the IBM badge program, but that was one of the things that we really started with. And a badge is really a micro-credential that has a lot of skills and metadata that are associated with it, as well as the learning that you achieve, you have acquired, taken to achieve that skill. So the first thing that we needed to do was be able to have a system that allowed us to take an inventory of the skills in the workforce. And so the IBM Open Badge Program was really amazing because it gave every single individual a way to document and demonstrate the skills that they had.
Well, that's very cool. So how would that happen? Would someone log in and provide certificates to prove there's certain levels of education, or what other kinds of things were involved with that?
Right. So we had to start at the beginning, right? So we had to look at the learning that we had and see whether, it was what we call resume worthy, whether it was really aligned with the skills that we needed someone to develop. So then we defined a badge and we aligned it with that learning. So every time an employee went and completed a particular learning, on completion, they got awarded this micro-credential. And this micro-credential then is part of your profile or your wallet of skills forever, right? And it kind of articulates what skills you acquired through that particular learning, and as well as what learning you took. And now, it initially, of course, we did learning, then we did some experience-based badges. We did badges for hackathons. We did badges for presenting at conferences. We did badges for volunteers. Because at the end of the day, the skills that an individual has is really a sum total of all the experiences that they go through. And so we wanted a way to be able to do that. And one of the interesting things that we found when we started the badge program was that it was extremely motivational. We saw course completion rates go up significantly because, now this was the learn and reward cycle that was going through, right? So an individual learned something, they got rewarded with a badge, and through that reward of the badge, they got recognized. So the badge, which is issued by Credly, can be put onto our internal IBM profile page, but it can also be displayed externally on your LinkedIn profile, or it can be shared with your social media outlets through Twitter. And so, we found that it became a great motivational piece. So the first step we did was, put in a system that really helped us to take an inventory of skills and really reward people. Mm-hmm. And what that then gave us was the ability to have a conversation with an employee based on what skills they had today, what skills we as an organization needed them to acquire, and gave us the way to have a conversation with them so that learning journey could be personalized. And so, let's go back to that learning system, the homegrown learning system that I mentioned we built out. That has, learning journeys, it has recommendations, it has ways in which specific paths have been curated. So as an example, let's say obviously we wanted people to learn about artificial intelligence as an example. So they're curated channels for artificial intelligence, you know. So it was a great way to kind of give them a personalized recommendation.
Cool. There are a couple of great questions in the question panel here. Sure. That I'll toss in. So you were talking about the badge experience that you felt you guys saw was motivating. Jill's asking, maybe the sort of the opposite shade of that though. Was there did you find there was a hesitancy of people to complete the skills inventory honestly, fearing it might be used to make workforce decisions?
Not really. You know, I think one of the things that I think which is really great is that all of this was accompanied with a culture shift, right? Mm-hmm. I think more and more the communication out to the employees was to encourage them to build out a growth mindset, to be curious, to really embrace learning, because this was something that was going to help us for the rest of our life. And so I'm sure there were some employees who were probably hesitant, and that's always there. But by and large, I think people were fairly good about doing a skills assessment, as well as trying to take badges, you know. So I will share a quick personal anecdote. You know, I'm a lifelong learner. I love learning. I read a lot. I listen to a lot of podcasts. But somehow it had always been difficult for me to sit and take a learning that was really associated with a badge. And last year, you know, like the rest of everybody in the world, you know, we were in a lockdown and we had all this time on our hands, you know, time in the sense time that I would probably have spent commuting or driving. So I actually followed through and took a couple of courses that led to badges. And it was really good, because all of a sudden, you know, there was this newfound visibility that those badges gave me, both inside the organization as well as outside the organization. So I think people look at the badges more as a reward and as a way to demonstrate their expertise, to establish their credibility, than a stick.
IBM is so big. As you're going through and talking about doing this, I just keep, like, my anxiety level starts going up a little bit, because I'm thinking to myself, it's this massive company, and like to roll out a project like this, I mean, it would be exceptionally overwhelming to me to go do that. So, I mean, it sounds like you took it in small pieces, right? Did some tests, you know, here and there. And, you know, technology stuff has a tendency, it seems like, to be the easiest to do this kind of stuff with, right? Because it's like, learn JavaScript, right? And there's different levels, you know, intermediate, advanced, whatever, and to do different types of features and things like that. But, you know, did you have to partner with other departments really heavily and have this be a really large company-wide experience? Or was it easy to just kind of keep it within the L&D team?
Oh, no. So a quick disclaimer, I am not part of IBM Learning. So like you said, IBM is a huge organization. We've got lots of different learning teams, and we have one specific team, which is called the IBM Learning team, which is responsible for employee education. I personally am not part of IBM Learning. I'm part of IBM Training and Skills, which is more responsible for the customer education. So I just want to put that out there, saying I'm not an expert at IBM Learning, but I'll still tell you that this was no easy feat. It's not possible for the learning group to have done this on their own, because you know, there are different business stakeholders. Each of the businesses have their own strategic imperatives that they need to meet, right, and have their own skills requirements that need to be supported for those strategic imperatives. So it's really a collaboration and a partnership, right, with the L&D team to be able to decide, you know, which are the skills, what skills are going to have the maximum business outcome, and really help, you know, partner with L&D to be able to create appropriate learning experiences that can help drive those skills. I think today, you know, the biggest buzzwords around, and the, I think the holy grail really, one is people analytics. You know, how do we really leverage people analytics to understand what is, you know, what learning is required, what are people taking, you know, how are they feeling, you know, where do they need to get to, as well as, you know, how do we really measure the business impact of learning? Because at the end of the day, that's what we really need to do. It's not learning just for the sake of learning, but it's also, it's really about learning for the business impact. And, you know, that's basically what it is. I want to pick up on one thing that you had mentioned, Brent. You know, one is technical training. You know, of course, that's the easiest thing to do. Like you said, you know, learn JavaScript, learn Python, you know, learn about IBM Cloud. But one of the things that I think as an organization, as an and as a world, we have really figured out is that the skills requirements today go way beyond just technical training, right? That just not just technical skills that you need to learn, but they're also human skills. I think there is a fantastic work, you know, which has been done, you know, which talks about the foundation skills that you need in terms of creative thinking, problem solving, teamwork, presentation and communications, you know, those are all the skills that you need, as well as some basic digital skills also, right? So, so I think that there's a hybrid mix of skills that need to be built in an individual today to really prepare them for the workforce that we are.
So your customers are getting these badges from you guys as well then? Is that what you're saying? I mean, you're making this training for them. So it's not just internal employees that benefit from the badges and whatnot, but the customers as well go through that process.
Absolutely. So, you know, I think, we actually started the pilot, you talked about, you know, rolling it out. The badge pilot actually started out on an external free learning platform that we have, which is Cognitive Class. It's one of the largest MOOCs out there. And you know, we really wanted to test this out, right? So we wanted to do a small pilot. I think we identified a couple of courses on Cognitive Class and assigned badges to them. And Cognitive Class is not just, it's not an IBM internal thing, it's an external thing. There's tons of free training up on there, which is not IBM training. You know, it's Hadoop, what is data science, what is artificial intelligence, very generic stuff that everybody needs to learn today. And we started with the badges there. And like I said, you know, we were amazed at the numbers that we got in terms of completions that went up. So that's what kind of encouraged us to roll out badges internally and externally. So yes, you know, there are a lot of external badges available. As part of being able to reach out into the social ecosystem. We have partnerships with a lot of different training partners, you know, so we have a network of delivery partners that provide from face-to-face training, you know, across the world in 199 countries, as well as self-paced online training through platform partners like Coursera and edX. And a lot of those trainings are badged because, yes, you know, as a customer also, you need to be able to take inventory of, you know, what skills your employees have. And also for your employees, it's a great reward. You know, it is something that they can take with them irrespective of which company they are part of. You know, so it's a great reward system for people. And now, you know, if you look at the whole conversation around learning and you look at the conversation even around higher education, right? We've all gone through this biggest experiment in education ever last year, you know, with the pandemic and everything closing down and things. You know, micro-credentials have taken on a new visibility. You know, they've really shown up for people, and the ability to stack credentials, you know. So today, it's not just IBM that's awarding badges. There are a lot of different organizations that are awarding badges. And so today, as an individual, I can, you know, I can display my IBM badges on my LinkedIn profile. I can take some LinkedIn learning and have that show up. I can take some Skillsoft training and have that show up. You know, so there are lots of different micro-credentials that are available that an individual can use to really build out their skills wallet and demonstrate to the world, you know, how varied and how diverse their skill set is. And I think that's really where we need to go. You know, that's the conversation. And then at IBM, one of the other things that we are doing, you know, since I'm talking about an ecosystem, I wanted to just close that loop real quick. You know, we've realized that we can't build all the training our employees need, right? There's no way we can do that because, you know, things change so fast. By the time we build something, it'll already be defunct. And so it's easier for us to partner with a lot of different partners and curate the content that is appropriate from them. So, you know, whether it's Harvard Business Review, whether it's O'Reilly, whether it's Coursera, whether it's edX, whether it's Udemy, you know, whoever it might be, we have the ability to bring in learning from different partners and supplement that with our own homegrown things. So it's really about creating an ecosystem of partners and being able to deliver of the appropriate training. And that's what we're trying to do for our customers too. Right. We realize that there is not a single source of training that is required that will meet all the needs for our customers. And so we're trying to plug ourselves in wherever our customers need it. Right. So as well as in colleges and in schools, you know, so there are so many different initiatives that at IBM we support. That give people the ability to get training for free or low-cost training through different platforms that are available.
Mm-hmm. We have a whole whack of
A whole whack of
Whoa. Something changed there. I'm getting a big echo. Maybe Brent, do you want to switch to looking at the question panel for me and I'll go back on mute?
Yeah, sorry about that. I don't know how that all of a sudden came up. Now I'm getting echo. Can anybody else hear that echo?
No, I don't hear an echo.
Oh, Clara hears it.
Yeah. Sonia, it may just be on your side. So if you go on mute for a heartbeat, while Brent asks the question and then come off again. We'll just take turns being on mute just to keep it limited.
Yeah, we'll figure it out. Was there a particular question you wanted me to go after there, Chris?
Well, take your pick. We've got six questions.
We've only
reached one so far, so go ahead.
Okay. It sounds very motivational. Some employees might feel inferior. Okay, that's the one we already asked. No, that's not.
We asked the one from Jill earlier. Hesitancy.
Oh, okay.
And this one is kind of definitely related, but it's not quite the exact same question. So go ahead with that one.
Yeah. Okay, good. So the micro badging sounds very motivational for some people, but I do wonder if there are some people who would be demotivated by it. Some employees might feel inferior if they aren't able to get as many badges as other employees. How do you keep this from becoming negative? And what are some of the pitfalls to avoid? And I'll just tag on a question that I had that's similar to that, you know, matching up those badges with HR and raises and because I know a lot of people when they get inside of corporate America, it's what do I have to do next to make more money or to move to the next step? And everybody wants to know exactly what that path is. And if I just take these classes, then I'm going to be able to move up and go to the next thing. Right. So that's kind of the thing I'm thinking of. And I think that kind of falls in line with people being motivated or demotivated or whatever. How do you make that connection?
Okay. Apologies if the echo is from my side, but so there are specific professions that have a very clear linear path. So we have, I think, five different professions within IBM. So let me just pick one as an example, a data science profession, right? So as an individual, if you want to be part of the data science profession, there are very clear levels that are articulated, as well as learning and certification and badges that you need to acquire, along with work experience, to get to that level, right? So I think it's very clear. It removes the ambiguity. Okay. It removes the manager discretion. It's a very clear path, you know? So if someone wants to become a data scientist and wants to follow that profession, it's extremely clear. Coming back to the demotivation or the comparison, you know, yes, that could be true. And I'll tell you, like I said, before last year, I hadn't gotten any badges. And so did I look at other people's profiles very enviously and feel demotivated because I didn't have a badge? Not really. Because it was just a question of, I think at the end of the day, we all need to be responsible for our own career and our own career path. And here's where I think the role of a manager comes in a big way. You know, so when you say, what can you do to really eliminate that feeling of inadequacy amongst employees, I think that's where a good relationship with the first line manager would really help, because it's, you know, there is a transparency that is required between the employee as well as the manager, and a clear recommendation in terms of what does that person need to do to get to the next level. And if there are essential skills in the organization that have to be built, that might be just one thing, right? I don't think anybody at IBM has ever got penalized for not getting a badge. You know, that doesn't happen. But it is a way to demonstrate that your learning quotient is high, that you are a curious person, and that, you know, you are a lifelong learner. And I think that really is the demonstration, and that is what people want to see. I mean, if you look at, I think it was LinkedIn Learning that had a report out there where they talked about the biggest, you know, the top requirement from an employer really is the learnability. Like, how well can this person learn? Because we know today it's impossible for you to be able to find the right person with every single skill that you need to do a job. But what you need to do is find someone that has the adjacent skills that you need and has the ability to get to the skills that are required to do a job with the directed learning and training and experiences that are there. So, you know, again, conversation with managers and employees, you know, clear transparency, that's what's required. A culture change in an organization to demonstrate that learning is valued and that a growth mindset is something that is encouraged, as well as the tools to support the learning and the recognition and the motivation, right? So I think all of those together is what is really going to make it successful. I did see a question about skills taxonomy, and you know, when we talk about the Holy Grail, you know, I did say trying to measure business impact for learning is one of the Holy Grails, but really the skills taxonomy is another one of them, you know, so that's really a huge thing. And we have tried to build out a skills taxonomy. Do we have a single skills taxonomy across the IBM company that everybody aligns to? I don't think we're quite there because that's just a huge piece of work. But we have standardized on a certain amount of skills, and as an organization, we're all trying to come together to align with those skills. So it's really a work in progress, you know, to really get to a single skills taxonomy that the entire organization can rally after.
Yeah, last week we talked about ontologies, and so maybe we need a skills ontology and start defining one of those instead. I don't know, we'll let Adam Weisblatt take care of that and figure that out for us. Let's take a look at one of those other questions. That's a good question too, Marcus. Thanks for asking that about taxonomy. It's great. Jill's got a question about, was there hesitancy of people to complete the skill? Oh, that's the one we already did. Yep. Right. Matt asks, I believe she answered this one. Thank you. Did you experience pushback from leadership while developing this amazing learning environment? Coming from a manufacturing background, pulling employee attention from production in order to take advantage of training is always a precarious balancing act.
And that really is, you know, so I think if you look at any of the surveys that are done, you know, number one obstacle to training is having dedicated time available to do it, right? That's really the biggest challenge that everybody has. And so again, this is where working with a manager comes in, because if it's really critical, so let's say, you know, you're getting put onto a project that requires certain skills, you know, the manager is obviously going to work with you to make sure that you have dedicated time put aside for that. But, you know, there have been a couple of really innovative things that, you know, the organization's done, you know, so like we've had, we used to have a couple of years ago, we had something called Think Fridays, you know, where you could take an afternoon off and be able to set aside some time to learn. We've had growth days in the organization where an entire day is, you know, so I'm part of, you know, from an IBM perspective, I'm part of a group called Finance and Operations. So what Finance and Operations did, you know, was 2 days last year, they set aside specific days in the spring and the fall, which were, you know, days of growth. They were marked as days of growth. And they provided us with curated channels, multi-channels that we could choose from. There were live events, there were self-paced events, you know, there were badges associated with it, you know, so there was some dedicated time that could be put aside. And then the other thing is that when it comes to learning, all kinds of things count, you know. So as an example, for me, doing this session today is a learning experience. And I can add this as my personal learning into my tracker. I'm a big walker. I walk at least 1 hour every day. Some days I listen to music, some days I listen to a book, but some days I'll just listen to podcasts. And, you know, this podcast is one of the podcasts that's on my repeat. And so that's another example of a personal learning that I would, you know, put into it. So, you know, we're really trying to encourage everyone to learn in the flow of work, learn in the flow of life, you know, and just go ahead and track all that learning and the skills you think you've acquired with that. So it doesn't have to be just a badged activity, right? So as an example, for Christmas, I got a masterclass subscription, right? Now, there are no badges associated with the masterclass. But I'm taking a couple of them on creative writing, on being authentic. And then I have been logging that into our system. We're supposed to, you know, we have something called Think 40. We're supposed to do at least 40 hours of learning in the year. That's the bare minimum that they encourage you to do. I mean, again, you're not going to get penalized if you don't reach those 40 hours, but that's what they encourage you to do. And so I've been logging those hours against my Think 40 and really making sure that I put in the skills that I have acquired even through those masterclass sessions. So I see a question about customer and supplier learning versus staff learning. I'm not quite sure, Jennifer, what exactly you mean by that. We do have every single business unit, you know, so we've got groups and we call them business units. As you know, IBM is kind of a combination of a lot of acquisitions that have taken place over the course of many, many years. And so every business unit has education teams that build education for internal enablement. So, you know, whether it's technical or sales enablement, they also build training, which is required for our business partners to be able to sell our solutions as well as implement our solutions. And then we also have customer education, right? So we have teams that build training around the products focused on how do we maximize the return on investment that our customers have made on our products. And there are really a lot of different ways in which, you know, we do that. So yes, when you say training your supply chain, that's really training our business partners who sell our products as well as create implement our products. So we've got an entire organization and we have a way in which, so if you go to ibm.com/training, you will see something called Partner World there. And that is the training portal for our business partners. Again, it's self-serve. There are curated channels there based on what kind of products you're selling and things like that. It's all there. And, you know, we provide our business partners with the ability to get badges too, as well as certifications, you know. So we have product certifications just like everybody else does. These are verified proctored exams that you take, and which also count towards membership levels for our suppliers, as you talk about that.
Mm-hmm. And now that you've got this the system in place and it's been running for a bit, Matt's got a really neat question. How much has the use of badges improved employee reception towards skill improvement or learning opportunities? Are you seeing a growth in interest in learning opportunities, et cetera?
Absolutely. Both internally and externally, we've seen a huge jump in the completion rates for learning after activities have been badged. It becomes a personal motivation thing, a personal accountability thing. It's you want that bling factor on your resume and on your profile. And so I think it's a huge motivator. And for people who are curious and like to learn, those badges are a good thing. And like I said, I'm now hooked onto it. I never believed in it, but last year, at the end of the year, when I did a couple of things and I got 4 badges and I got all the recognition for it, I'm like, ooh, this is cool. So I'm going to definitely try and increase the number of badges I have and take more. So, we have, I think we've issued about 4 million badges since we've started the badge program. And I want to say maybe half of them have been issued to IBMers. Don't quote me on the number. Again, I'm not the expert here, but I would think about half have been issued to IBMers.
Neat. Even the simple act of making something public rather than simply, you've completed a course and it's in the LMS and maybe your manager knows that, but nobody else knows. But the simple act of exposing that out, like you said, you get feedback, other people notice, or maybe, hey, I saw that you did this or whatever, is an additional level of feedback, motivation, et cetera, beyond just completing things in the LMS. So that's really cool.
It sounds like a great conversation starter too, right? So if somebody else happens to be looking at somebody else's profile and they see where they're at and the kind of work they do, and they look at the different badges that they have, it'd be like, oh, I wonder what that badge is, and maybe they introduce themselves and say, hey, I'm really interested in that and want to know what you're doing. So there seems to be so many different levels that could actually, that play into the success of something like this.
And I'm glad you brought that up, Brent, because one of the big things that is there today is the concept of a talent marketplace, right? Inside an organization, even outside an organization, So how do you participate in a talent marketplace without having the ability to showcase the skills that you have? So, if someone's taking doing a project, I'll give you a quick example. As part of Global Business Services, GBS, which is one of our consulting teams, they were working on a project for a skills inference engine. And, they came across my profile based on the badges that I had. They reached out to me and said, we're working on a skills and inference engine, and would you like to participate as a consultant on the project? And I'm like, okay, sure, but how did you get to know about me? And they're like, oh, we searched on this particular skill and your name came up and we saw the badges that you had, and we thought we'd reach out to you. So it's perfect. So yes, Jennifer, making skills available through IBM Blue Pages, internally for IBM, but also externally via LinkedIn, would be great, right? And the thing is that anybody can click on your badge. So I'd encourage everyone, go to my profile, go to my LinkedIn profile. I'd love to connect with you if you'd like to connect with me. But if you click on the badges that are there on my profile, it'll take you to Credly, and you can then see what are the skills associated with all those badges that I have. and what learning did I take to get those? You know, and you'll see a mix. There's some design thinking, there's agile, there's some soft skills, and there's some leadership stuff. You know, those are the four. I have only four badges right now, but, you know, it'll give you an idea what I'm talking about. And let me see if I can put in my LinkedIn profile real quick. I'm sorry. I know I was supposed to keep the link handy, but, you know, I'll do that whilst you guys are winding up.
Yeah,
most excellent. This has been a great conversation. And the questions, I can't recall the last time we had this many questions actually posted in the question panel. So that's awesome. I think we managed to cover most or at least angles of most of the questions that were there. So obviously, though, if folks have other questions and they do connect with you on LinkedIn, that's a chance for them to follow up and ask more for more details, etc. So cool. Sonia, thank you so much for joining us here today. This has been really, really quite cool. And we'll dance on out of here into the rest of our Wednesday. As always, thanks to everybody for the great stuff in the chat.
Thank you for the opportunity. Stay safe, everyone. Bye.
Absolutely. It was nice to meet you too.
Brent? Yeah, there we go.
There we go.
There's the volume button.
Hey, listen, give him some special effects, Chris. Thanks, everybody.